recording this?
I'm recording this because I am going to talk about tunneling, you know, with SSH. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, some of you may want to review the notes, you know, not the notes, you know, but just the concept and what I talked about in the class. So that's why I'm recording this. Alright. So I know you guys are all busy, you know, trying to get the Kerber rules and LDAP homework done. But I want to just kind of get started with the next topic. When you go to Moodle, and somebody said, you know, do not mention the last item over there, saving you for Halloween. Oh, I forgot one thing. I forgot to plug myself onto the network. We are on Crash and Burn right now. Okay, so I found that this is another way to get yourself back, you know, connected back to the network after Crash and Burn. The first thing is, you know, of course, you know, change to root first. And then you want to look at the network interfaces. And E0 is not even there. So, okay, that's okay. You type ifconfig, and E0 is here. So the quickest way to do it is to actually run this command called ifconfig. You already know ifconfig. If you don't supply any arguments to it, it will just report back, you know, the current interfaces and how they're connected. But you can actually supply eth0 to specify, I'm going to configure eth0 at this point. And you can give it, you know, an address. In other words, you can specify the static IP just like that. On this machine, it's 130. You can also specify the net mask, 255.255.255.128. And then you can confirm with ifconfig eth0, because if you have multiple interfaces, it will just, you know, go through all the interfaces. I'm only interested in eth0 at this point. And you can see eth0 now has this IP address. The second thing we need to do is to make sure that we add the default gateway correctly. So that is just route. Add default gateway is abbreviated as GW, and then give it the IP address, which is 165.196.117.254. Press the enter key. So now we have internet connectivity, but one last item is to make sure that we have the DNS or the name server set up correctly. So we'll just take a quick look at resolve.conf first. It is currently empty, but that's okay. We'll just go ahead and give it some content. You just have to say name server, and you'll give it 8888, which is a Google name server, and that should be it. Once you have everything done, and you can try to ping google.com, and if it pings, that means everything is working, because this means that you can at least get out of the local area network. Two, you have the name server set up, and, you know, so you have, you know, full connectivity at this point. Yep.
You're saying this is faster as an alternative to running your script?
You can put all those commands into a script. Okay, so I can go back, you know, I can just use the up arrow key to find out what command I type here. Now this is also a trick. How do you turn a command that you have typed into a script? Okay, does anyone want to know how to do that?
Sure.
Or this is like, yeah, we know how to do that already.
By turning the execution bit on, right?
Nope. Well, this is a command that I just type on the keyboard. You can, if you want to, kind of scroll back and do the copy and paste thing. But I would just do this. I would use echo, put a double quote in front of the command, put a double quote at the very end of that command, and then use the redirect symbol, which is the greater than symbol, to a script file. Then you're just redirecting that command without executing it to a file. So in this case, I would put it into tilde, which means this is the home folder of root itself. And I'll just say setup network.sh. I can go back and, you know, add the shebang line and stuff later. The second thing I did was to add, you know, do this part, you know, add route add default gateway. Same thing, do an echo, and then put double quotes around the actual command, but this time use double greater than
to append,
exactly. So now that the file already exists, I can just, you know, do a tab and find out where it is. There we go. So now we have the second command. And here's the third command. The third command is a little bit tricky because we have to do an echo. But I actually did not use a command to put in 8888 as my name server, I actually use an editor to put that in. So one way to do it is to use echo within that. And here it's a little bit tricky. I'll explain this. Name server 8888, and then we have backslash double quote double greater than tilde slash setup network.sh. Okay, so it's a good time to explain what this mess is about.
Is this being recorded two times?
It is being recorded. Yep. We'll go to appearance, change the font size a little bit because I think it's really important that you see the actual command here. Okay, so what I want to do is to explain that last part. Okay, this is the part that I want to explain. Okay, so this is the actual command that I'm executing because it is not in double quotes in any way. So I'm actually executing the echo command, which is equivalent to a print command. It would you just specify what you want to print, and normally it is printed to standard out, which is, you know, the screen. But when you put the double greater than symbol here, it is used to append to a file. Okay, so whatever you specify is output, you know, to a file or appended to a file. But what am I exactly outputting to a file? Well, it's everything here. Okay, this is everything within the double quotes. But what about this double quote here? Now this double quote means nothing to this echo command because it has a backslash in front of it, which means it is escaped. Okay, so this is how you can actually print something that has a double quote when everything is enclosed in double quotes. Okay, so let's go ahead and, you know, press enter and find out what this command does. Okay, so we'll go ahead and actually take a look at the file that I just created and find out whether it has all the necessary content. Well, I forgot one thing. Okay, what this will do is it will actually just print name server 8888 to the screen, but I don't want to print it to the screen. I want this to become the content of the resolved file. So this is actually what I want to do, is to, you know, redirect it to the resolve.conf file. So this will become my new script to run every single time when I log in or to these computers when we are on crash and burn. And so far this has been very reliable. I have not, you know, the connection has not been dropped on me, and, you know, it's, this is as low level as it gets.
Are people having trouble with the former script?
The other script? Some people are getting the connection dropped, you know, periodically, but this one, you know, I have not experienced any problems.
Every time I run it at home, and then when I come back in here, I have to do that manually, what he's just been describing.
Yep, so you can put it into a file, and I would just run the file. Of course, I, you know, did not do the last part here, which is the shebang line. Give it, you know, sh, and then chmod au plus x, and then send it up to the file. So this time, you know, every time I log in, I can just go ahead and run that file, and I'll be done. Okay, but this is not really related to what I want to talk about in this class. I just have to set it up so that I can access the web, but I just thought, you know, you guys may be interested in this as well. Okay. Little tricks. Now we can go online. And now today's topic is actually quite fun. How many people have had the need or want to, you know, log in to your home machine because you forgot to do one thing and it is on your home machine?
It'd be helpful.
Will be helpful, okay?
All the time.
Yes. All the
time?
You don't think you can do it? Okay. So, sorry? Well, we'll find out, you know, how it can be done, okay? It's called SSH tunneling, okay? It's called SSH tunneling, or the technique, or it is a tunneling technique. And I just want to point out where in the notes, you know, we are talking about, what in the notes we are talking about. It is in topic 5, you know, VNC plus X11 plus SSH, you know, that's the topic. It actually covers a little more than, you know, just, you know, tunneling and VNC, but tunneling all by itself is actually a very interesting topic already. All right, I don't actually have any pictures in the notes, so it's kind of dry, and, you know, so what I'll do is I'm going to introduce some pictures right now. the nice, you know, this is a very nice program for drawing pictures like on the fly. It's called Inkscape. It's kind of like a Adobe Freehand, except it's open source. Okay, so we'll go ahead and change the paper first. We'll change the paper to US letter size, landscape mode. Okay, all right, and then we'll zoom in to the main portion. All right, now let's go ahead and draw the picture of, you know, what this situation is, which is, this is a very common situation. Okay, the situation is that you have a computer here, and then we'll just have, you know, two computers here, and we'll have a router here. Definitely not a Cisco type of symbols, but, you know, it's okay. And if you guys don't like, you know, these colors, you know, filled, you can go ahead and unfill them. So we'll go to fill and turn it all to nothing. Now we only have boxes. All right, so it's helpful to give these boxes names. And I'll just give this box, you know, office one. And this one here is going to be our residential gateway. Does everybody understand when I say a residential gateway?
Sorry.
It's your router box at home. Okay. And now we have, this is one of your home boxes. We can work with just one, we can work with two, it doesn't matter. So we'll just call this your net box. In other words, this is the main box that is connected to the internet. You might be running your own web server, you know, or something like that. So this is your net box that is, you know, somewhere in a closet. You don't access it all the time. You don't need physical access to it all the time. And here is your desktop computer. Desktop. And that's your, that's the machine that you access most of the time at home when you need to do something. Okay? Is the setup okay so far? Does everybody understand what each symbol represents? Netbox is a box that sits in a closet. And desktop is the one that has a 30-inch monitor that you use most of the time for, you know, doing your homework assignments and whatnot. The 30-inch monitors are now down to, what, $300 or less? That's just insane. I still remember my 19-inch CRT costing me like $300, and it was a super bargain at the time. All right. Now you have to pay someone to get rid of something like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just for the disposal.
So what I'm doing now is I'm just grouping these objects. So when I move, I'm moving the objects as a whole and not just, you know, one component of it. It's just handy to be able to do that. All right. Now there's one more thing here that I'm not drawing. It's the firewall to Office One. In other words, you're working from your office, but, you know, if you work for, you know, any company, just about any company, they will set up a firewall so that incoming traffic will be mostly blocked. Okay, almost 100% will be blocked, you know, and you cannot get to your own machine. So let's go ahead and, you know, draw that box here, and we'll just have another gateway. So between these two groups, we have the internet. So the internet is here. Is that okay so far?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So the question now is, you are running Windows on this machine here, and from your office, you want to log in to your desktop to do one thing. The question is, how do you do that? That's the question. Well, SSH. But how do you set up SSH in this case? In other words, how are you going to set up SSH so that you can get control of the desktop, the GUI, not just a command line, not telnet. I want a full GUI of my desktop machine when I am in my office. That's the question.
Port forward and VNC.
You have to do port forwarding, okay? There are several things you have to do first. First of all, this gateway has to be set up to accept connections to port 22 or whichever port number you want to use as your SSH port. Okay? So that's up to you. Most people accept port 22 as the SSH port. Okay, so you have incoming port here. And what do you do when your gateway is accepting, you know, port 22? It can only forward it to one machine.
Machine we specify as far as for to accept that
correct.
SSH.
So now the question is, you know, where do you want that port 22 to forward to? Do you want it to forward to netbox, or do you want to forward it to desktop?
Desktop.
Well, if you forward it to desktop, that means, you know, all connections, all SSH connections will be going to your desktop box. So it depends on, you know, what operating system you're running on your desktop and whether desktop itself has sensitive data. You may not want to do that. Okay, you may not want to forward port 22 directly to a machine that you use all the time. If your netbox here doesn't really have anything important on it, that would, you know, serve as a good, you know, kind of like a, how do you call that, airlock, you know, area where you can, you know, where if it is compromised, you know, it's not as big of a deal as your desktop computer. So the way we set it up is, you know, port 22 will be forwarded from gateway to netbox. So when from outside there's a port 22 connection, it will go through the gateway and then we'll go to netbox first, okay? So now we just have to draw an arrow.
Can you make your VNC connection then from the netbox to your desktop?
Sorry?
Can you make your VNC connection then from your desktop to the...
No, so far there's no VNC yet. Okay, so VNC comes in later. Okay, we'll go to fills and strokes, go to stroke, change the style. We'll have end. An arrow. Oh, that's awful. That's not the kind of arrow that I want. Okay, let's do that again. Okay. Let's use a small arrow. Does that work? Too small. Let's do something bigger. I think that's good. Yeah? Okay. So port 22 is forwarded from the gateway to the netbox. All right. Okay, so what this is doing is you need to have, okay, which machine needs SSH server in this case?
The netbox.
The netbox, that is correct. So I'm going to say, you know, this is port 22. This is kind of like a convention, you know, when you use a colon to separate whatever, you know, usually the IP address from the port number. So when I say, you know, colon 22, it is just kind of implying that we are forwarding port 22 to netbox. All right, so Office One needs to have a what? It needs to have a
SSH client.
SSH client. Very good. Okay, so SSH client, you know, goes from Office One through this gateway, and most of the time they will let outgoing connections go through. Most Firefoxes only stop incoming traffic automatically, but most outgoing traffic are allowed because, you know, the assumption is, you know, people from the inside are can be trusted. So when they make an outgoing connection, it usually is okay. So I'm assuming that you can make a port 22 connection all the way from Office One through this gateway. It's not going to be blocked by this firewall, through the internet to your home gateway to the netbox itself. Okay. In other words, I'm going to do this. Let me pick a color here. Just going to pick a blue color. So. It's not blue, it's gray. We'll fix that. Okay, stroke, paint. We want to make it blue. Color wheel.
This is bright green.
Change the saturation. Yeah, we'll increase the thickness a little bit. There we go. Are we doing okay so far? All right, so what do we do next? So at this point, you have opened up an you can open an SSH session to the NetBox itself. But remember, your NetBox has nothing. Okay, the whole point is you can park it, you know, there so that, you know, if the box gets compromised, there's nothing important on that box. Okay?
And then, are you ultimately trying to make it to the desktop? Is that what you're getting at?
Sorry?
Are you ultimately trying to make it to the desktop?
Yep. Ultimately, we want to make it to the desktop.
So, even the X11 to that.
Okay, so let me ask you guys another question. From your NetBox here, do you think you can trust, you know, you can, do you think can trust someone who has access to NetBox to open a connection to your desktop? Are they going to be on the same subnet?
On the same LAN, I would think so.
They're going to be on the same subnet, right?
Yeah.
So it's kind of natural that, you know, from NetBox you can open a connection to your desktop. Okay. So desktop needs to run a VNC server. Okay. VNC stands for
Virtual Network Computing. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we want to run. Okay. Let me just comment on the stuff that we just talked about here. I'm gonna use a smaller font. So this one needs open SSH server, and then this one needs to run a VNC server. Are we doing okay so far? The open SSH server is what you need to answer connections from port 22. The VNC server basically, you know, makes whatever you see on the screen to be remotable, okay, so that you can export everything remotely. Okay. Office One needs both kinds of clients. It needs an SSH client and also a VNC client. Okay, so we'll go ahead and draw that here. So you need an SSH client as well as a VNC client.
So you're actually going to be running both of those clients then at the same time. Once
Correct.
You open the shell,
right.
SSH will run the VNC client.
Not quite yet. Mm-hmm. All right. When you run VNC, the convention is it will use port 5900 as a port to listen to. In other words, with your desktop here, it'll be listening to port 5900. So let me comment on that first here. Okay, so port 5900 is going to be available, and your desktop is listening to that port. Basically, it's saying, "Hey, I got, you know, this GUI screen that I'm ready to export. Who wants to see what's going on here?" Okay, and it's just waiting for someone to connect to it to share the desktop. Are we doing okay so far? But inside this network, only NetBox can connect to desktop. And guess what? NetBox is, you know, so primitive, it doesn't even have a GUI. So what we are going to do is to say, well, it would be nice if we're in the office, but it is as if we are actually here on NetBox itself. Now, this is the most important part. How do we have telepresence? Okay, that's essentially telepresence. Physically, we are here in the office, on the office machine, and you're saying, well, I'm on the office machine, but I would like to do something on the network at home as if I'm on NetBox itself. Are we doing okay so far with that concept? It's called, you know, but because this is really the essential part of this exercise, is tunneling. Okay, so what we'll do is when we open up this connection, the SSH connection here, we'll also specify to say, I want to tunnel. I want to do some port forwarding here. Okay, so the port forwarding is going to do it like this. The blue line represents SSH, and then we have a green line to represent that will work. Okay, the green line represents the connection that you want to make to desktop. So observe this part here. This is going to be fun. So we'll have the green line going like this, and then it disappears. It reappears here. And go all the way to desktop. Oh man, it didn't change the color. Okay, I'm gonna change the color here. Okay, what just happened? How many people know what is a wormhole? We have a wormhole. Yeah, well, we have a wormhole here. A wormhole is basically a tear in, you know, space and time. So you can go in, you know, from one end, and then you get out from the other end, but the two ends can be separated by space or time in some cases, you know, and there's no limit to that, you know, separation. See, this is the same thing. Okay, the blue line is okay. I don't want to walk over there because my microphone is not going to pick up as clearly. Okay, the blue line is your wormhole. Okay, you're establishing a wormhole when you build that blue line. Okay, but once you build the wormhole or the tunnel, the green line is representing you want to make a connection to the VNC. So the green line is going through on your office machine. It will go through the blue line, and then when it's in the blue line, no one can see the green line. The system administrator of, you know, of your company cannot see that you're trying to remote back onto your home machine. They can only see that you're opening an SSH connection to an IP address, presumably your home, you know, IP address, but they don't know what you're doing with your SSH connection. At this netbox here, where you're running open SSH server, the connection to VNC comes out of this end, and because when it comes out of this end, netbox is a local box to your local area network at home, then you can make the connection to desktop, you know, which has a port number of 5900. Are we doing okay so far with this?
So does it matter if your netbox is a different operating system like Linux?
Correct. Now that's a very good point. VNC is completely cross-client capable. That means Office One can be a PC.
Right.
Netbox can be a Linux box. Okay, it can be a Linux box with 128 megabytes of RAM. Yep.
Do your commands change once you've obviously established the SSH connection to NetBox? Do you have to? Is there anything that differs in your commands that you enter?
Yes, I will talk about the commands later, but let's focus on the concept first. And your desktop can be a Mac. Okay, all three machines here can be completely different, and VNC will still work fine. Now, NetBox doesn't really care because, you know, the VNC protocol was never interpreted by NetBox itself. That's between Office One and desktop. But VNC itself is also operating system independent. It's even better than X11 in some ways because you can make it work with Windows, which, you know, most of the time we don't have an X11 server for Windows. There are such things, you know, but normally we don't install that. Okay. So let's talk about the commands, because I'm pretty sure some of you are kind of curious, what kind of command do we run to get this done? All right, the first command that we have to run is to open up the connection. Okay. To open up the connection, you have to run it from Office One, which is your SSH client. And I think you guys want to make the font a little bigger, 24. What did I do? There we go. Okay, so. Come on. I did something and changed how the system responds to keyboard. Okay, so we have SSH here. Now you have to specify the usual stuff later on, but we'll also need a dash uppercase L option. In this case, you know, 5900 colon and then you specify desktop, which is an IP address. I'm just using desktop here in place of its IP address at home, and then colon 5900. And then you have to specify your username at your netbox address. Okay, so at home. So here you have your command, and let me change the font size a little bit so it's more visible. All right, this is the command that you run from your office machine. And some people will say, but I don't have OpenSSH on my office machine because it's a Windows box. Well, you have PuTTY, okay, PuTTY PuTTY. PuTTY actually has the capability to do port forwarding and stuff like that. You have to kind of find it. I cannot remember exactly where to find it, but I can show you later on. But you can run effectively this command. Now, what this means is, let me just explain the different parts here. The first 5900 refers to port 5900 on Office One itself. The second part, desktop colon 5900, refers to the IP address of desktop, but this is a local area network address. In other words, it can be 192.168, blah, 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 blah. It's not an internet exposed address. It's completely internal to your own network. Okay? And what it means is, when you try to make a connection to the local host 5900 on Office One, that connection will be teleported to over here. So the second part from desktop colon 5900 is seen from the perspective of netbox. Are we doing okay so far? The first part is local to Office One. The second part is seen from the perspective of the machine running OpenSSH server, which is a netbox.
So it's telling the netbox to forward that port?
Yes, that's what it's saying. It's telling netbox to say, you know, go ahead and forward these connections to desktop and port 5900. If there's a connection local to Office One, okay, let me pick different numbers. I think it's better to use different numbers just so that we don't confuse it. Okay, so we'll pick 5905 here. That makes it a little better. Okay, so what this means is, if there's a connection to port 5901 on Office One, that connection will now be forwarded through the blue line to netbox, and netbox itself will try to open up a connection to desktop port 5900. Okay, that's what port forwarding is about. Now, your desktop is already sitting there waiting for someone to connect to port 5900. So the connection will just go through. Exactly. So the next command you have to run in order to make that connection is the following.
So it won't even ask for a password then?
It will ask for a password, because SSH automatically asks for a password unless you use key pair authentication.
So is the netbox asking for the password, or is it your desktop?
Netbox will ask a password for SSH purposes. Mm-hmm. You can also set up desktop to ask another password for VNC connection. So you can have two different passwords in this case. Yep.
What if your desktop is your home computer and your IP address can't?
We'll address that later. Okay. Yep. Mm-hmm. Normally, when you have an active connection, your ISP won't change your IP address. You know, so we'll talk about that next. Okay. So here you're going to run your VNC viewer or some kind of VNC client. And you can use, you know, tight VNC, real VNC. There are a couple of free VNC clients that you can, you know, download for Windows. So when you make this connection, this is the interesting part. You basically connect to localhost or 127.0.0.1, and you connect to port 5905. Change the font size. So this is the first command to make the blue line. This is the second line to make the green line. Okay. Are there any questions?
So the second line still talking to your...
The second line relies on the first line because the first line establishes a wormhole. Mm-hmm. And then the second line is reaching into the wormhole to the other side.
So is the 5900 port establishing the connection to desktop? And then the 5905 is going to be the VNC data transfer port? Or?
5905 is the local port on Office One that is being listened to by the SSH client.
Okay,
all right, gotcha. Yep. Yeah, basically the first step is, you know, is to dial the gate in Stargate, you know, terminology. You know, you can see how, you know, maybe I should make that a prerequisite to this class, is you need to have taken the, you know, Stargate 101, you know, before taking this class. Because it's the same terminology. It really is the same thing. Okay, you know, the first thing is you have to dial the other gate, okay, to establish a wormhole, a stable wormhole. And then the second step, which is VNC viewer, is to actually, you know, radio through. Okay, you're just using a phone, you know, and you have, you know, one phone on one side of the Stargate and you have another phone on the other side of the Stargate. But there are two numbers now, because one, you have to dial the gate first. That's the first number. And that's a SSH, which means you need to authenticate to the SSH server running on NetBox first. Mm-hmm. The second one is to use your walkie-talkie, standing, you know, on one side of the wormhole or the Stargate, and use your, you know, walkie-talkie, set up the right channel to talk to the other side. So that's your second authentication, which is, you know, connection to port 5900 on desktop.
And it'll give you desktop control at this point.
Correct. Now, you know, if this connection is successful, then VNC viewer will actually display your desktop remotely. Now you can set up, you know, if you worry about things, you can set up, you know, the VNC server to be view only. In other words, you know, people cannot control your mouse, they cannot actually do things, but they can only see remotely what you're doing on your own desktop. But in this situation, you probably don't want that. You want to be able to control your desktop.
Would that be good if you're trying to give some kind of a, if you had, say, like remote employees and you're trying to show them something?
Yes, you can do it this way too. You can share a desktop. Yeah. Yep, you can do it that way.
Is this the way the companies are doing the remote repairs on computer systems now?
No, that's Windows' own, what is the name of that protocol? Desktop sharing protocol. They have their own, you know, desktop sharing protocol. No, not SharePoint. It's something else. I cannot remember the name. Yeah. Yeah, something like that. I cannot remember the exact name. But Windows has its own protocol, but VNC works on Windows too, so you can go through VNC to remotely control a desktop. Now, the nice thing about doing this is, what if you have another desktop? What if, you know, you have, you know, at home you have another desktop here? Well, another desktop will have another IP address. So you can set this one up, you know, to have, you know, port 5901. And this command, you know, you can chain as many dash L blah 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 as you want. In other words, you know, you can forward more connections than just one. You can forward a whole bundle of connections through a single port 22 connection. So you can bounce everything, you can quote unquote bounce everything off of NetBox at home. And now you can remote into, you know, just about any PC at home. Yep.
So is that SSH server, all that basically is kind of like the data then, because you just don't have the IP address to transfer?
Say again? I cannot.
It creates the tunnel and lets you tell you what IP address to connect to also?
You have to explicitly state that here, you know, like in this case, you know, desktop is the local address of desktop on your local area network. That is correct. Yes. Yes. Okay. So are there any questions about this part before I move on and talk about your concern?
So it would matter if let's say the NetBox was Windows XP and the desktop was, you were running Ubuntu on.
Does not matter, as long as, you know, it can run and some form of SSH server that implements port forwarding, and all of them should.
So Windows, the XP has a open SSH.
Yep, it has a SSH server you know, that can also do port forwarding.
Is that shareware too, or open source?
I do not know for sure. That part I don't know for
sure. Is this concerning the gateway address changing from the ISP?
Sorry?
Is this concerning the gateway address changing from the as a result of the ISP dynamically changing it?
Okay, well, that's the question. You know, how do you get back to your own box, you know, when you're not on a static IP? Now, depending on who is your ISP, you know, they may charge you as little as $5 per month for a static IP. That's with
Shorewest.
Okay, Shorewest only charges like $5 a month for a static IP. But some other companies may charge more. I would imagine, you know, AT&T wants your leg, arm, and your firstborn at the same time.
Well, if you're using a cable.
Huh?
What's the workaround then?
To work around?
As far as if your IP address keeps changing, you buy a static IP.
There are several ways to get around the step at the IP changing, you know, kind of thing. The first one is, you know, you just have to subscribe to some service like NoIP, no-ip.com. Okay, so no-ip is, you know, they call themselves, you know, managed DNS or something like that. Basically, they are a lookup service, okay? You can get a free account with NoIP, and you have to run a particular program on your home box. And every time, you know, periodically, it will just, you know, update NoIP and say, oh, by the way, my IP address has now changed to blah, 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 blah. Okay, so NoIP keeps track of your the actual IP of your home machine.
It just sends your IP to them. That's all it does, right?
Right, so when you want to make a connection, you connect to www.no-ip.com/tilde, whatever username you choose to use, and that will resolve to a numeric IP address. So now you get your own IP address back. Even if it changes, you can always, you know, go from a domain name, which does not change, back into the dynamic IP address that changes over time. But nothing is going to save you if your ISP decides to change the IP address, you know, when you still have an active connection going on. Because if you go back to the other picture, the blue line is always there. This is a long call, you know, to, you know, through the gates, you know, through the stargates. So, you know, yeah, I mean, that works really well. I mean, that terminology works really well.
So the tunneling keeps you hid from what you're actually doing, for anybody else.
There's several things that is advantageous of this. First of all, the system admin of, you know, at work, they can monitor the gateway here.
Right.
But when they monitor the gateway here, all they see is one thin blue line, you know, of port 22, SSH connection going out. That's all they see. Okay, but within that SSH connection, within a single connection, you can make it the tunnel of 5, 6, 5, 50, 500, you know, actual, you know, connections to your home, you know, network. But to the administrator, it only appears as one single connection. Well, if you're a hacker, you know, if you're a system administrator, you would actually worry about the other way around. Okay, if someone hacks into your home machine, which is out of the control of your administrator at work, can that someone go back to your office one? That is the major concern of an administrator. I mean, if you use it this way, yes, you can definitely goof off, you know, because you can run your home browser, you know, at home and set it to, you know, watch news or go to Amazon, go shopping or whatever. And, you know, the administrator, unless your administrator can see what you do on Office One, they can only see that you have an SSH1 connection to an unknown box somewhere and not Amazon.com, not Yahoo, and so on and so forth. So that's only for, you know, catching people slacking off, which is not a main concern of an administrator. The opposite way is a major concern is if someone compromises your net box, can that person go back to your Office One and start to, you know, hack into your office machine? That is the major concern.
This is an easier target.
Hmm? Because it is an easier target, and the administrator at work has no control of that machine. So they cannot make sure that you run, you know, virus checkers, you know, firewalls, and everything else is set up correctly. So if you have a weak connection or weak security box here, someone can go through port 22, hack into this box. The question is, once you hack into that box, can that person go all the way back to Office 1? Not the way we set it up right now. Okay. In other words, when you use dash L, you are only forwarding connections one way. Okay. In other words, the client, exactly, the client can use a walkie-talkie to initiate a, you know, to talk to the other side, but the walkie-talkie is not receiving. They cannot make a connection back to this walkie-talkie.
Well, we all know that everybody likes to go home and work from home back to work.
So the question is, how can we do that? All right. Are we doing okay with this slide?
Mm-hmm.
Shall we save it? Maybe. Okay, I'll just save this one.
Save it and post it, right?
Yeah, I can save and post. Okay, so I'll make this, you know, SSH-L. Okay, so this one is saved. Now the question is, what if someone says, you know, I want to work from home? This allows me to control my home box from work for casual stuff, okay? But how do I go the other way and go from my desktop back to work? That's the question.
VPN.
Well, there are several things you have to change. You cannot change the SSH client because you're still making the tunnel from Office 1 to NetBox. So that part cannot change. But you can change VNC client to VNC server here. That's the first step you have to do. Okay? In other words, you turn Office 1 into a VNC server and it's saying, okay, I'm ready to accept connections at port 5901. Okay, so let me just make an annotation about that here.
Couldn't you also need an SSH server as well to encrypt that tunnel?
Nope. Mm-mm. That's the really tricky part of, you know, how can we do this without running an SSH server on Office 1? As far as SSH is concerned, it doesn't change from the previous picture. Office 1 is still the SSH client. NetBox is still the SSH server. But as far as VNC is concerned, they are now reversed.
So you can flip the connection virtually?
Well, you have to install different software in this case because the client does not always contain the server software. Sorry? Yes, type VNC comes with both, yes. And type VNC can also start automatically, which can be a security issue. The VNC protocol itself is actually not very secure, but once you tunnel through SSH, that makes it secure. Okay, so that's why SSH is so useful, because you can use it as a container to hide, you know, traffic that is not by themselves, you know, secure.
That's why it's scary.
Well, you know, you can go back to the office. Okay, so the question now is, how do we go back? Okay, this port is no longer listening. We still have port 22 here. Your NetBox is still listening to port 22. Well, the change you have to do is with your command here. So your command over here has to change. Instead of using a dash uppercase L, you change it to dash uppercase R. Okay, for reverse, yep. Mm-hmm. And you also have to make some changes here, because this is no longer, actually this is still correct. Okay, this is still correct here, except this port is now changed to 5901 because the local port is now 5901. But the remote port that is listening is 5900. In other words, what I'm doing is I'm opening up port 5900 on NetBox now. Okay, so this part requires some explaining.
See, could you have the VNC server and the VNC client running on the office machine at the same time?
Yes, you can. Yep. Okay, so let me explain this command a little bit here. The dash R means, you know, reverse. So when you run this command, what happens is it will make a connection from Office 1 to NetBox as an SSH connection. That part has not changed. But what does change is how is port forwarding. At this point, when the connection, you know, when the connection is established, what the SSH server will do in this case is it will listen to port 5900 on NetBox. And that's the 5900 that you specify here. So NetBox will now listen to port 5900 and say, okay, you know, I'm ready to accept connections. But it's not going to take any accept connection from everybody. It will only take connections from desktop in this case. So that's what desktop is when you specify the command line. So NetBox will only forward the connections to port 5900 from desktop. Where is it forwarding that connection to? It's forwarding that connection to 5901 of Office 1. Okay, so you have to look at the green line exactly the opposite way now. You're from home, you're working from home, running your VNC client, and all you have to do is from your VNC client, you point it to NetBox and say, I want to open up port 5900 on NetBox. NetBox running OpenSSH server will say, oh, okay, you know, I have, you know, incoming traffic from desktop through port 5900, I know where to forward it to. Then it will go through the wormhole, the green, the blue line, all the way back to Office 1. Office 1 is already listening to 5901 because it is running the VNC server. When you run the VNC server, you can tell it which port to listen to. In this case, I'm asking it to listen to port 5901. So that means this command, you don't run it here. Okay, so the way you do it now is when you run your VNC client, let me switch to here. When you run your VNC client, you run it from here. So you say VNC viewer or whatever, you know, command you choose to use. And this time you open it up to NetBox port 5900. Okay, this command will cause this green line to go in this direction to NetBox. NetBox says, oh, I got a Stargate open already, so I'll send that traffic through the Stargate, and the traffic will reappear on Office 1. And Office 1 is saying, oh, I'm already listening to port 5901, so we are all good. The connection will establish.
So the SSH connection, you just leave it indefinitely running, or will it start up? You just leave it indefinitely
running? You have to leave it running indefinitely, or you can run a script on Office 1 to check whether the connection is still up. If not, you can restart that connection. So this is the reverse, okay? And IT, you know, people are mostly concerned about this one because this can reverse the traffic back to Office 1.
So at that point, you could do anything in the office that you could do from your home.
Yes. Now, VNC by itself, you know, is not extremely damaging because you're only exporting the desktop, okay? If there are things that you cannot, you know, do with a desktop, then a hacker who can hack into your whole machine is kind of limited in terms of what that person can do.
So you're only back to your own credentials that you have at the office.
Correct. But it's already damaging enough because if a hacker gets onto Office 1, that hacker can use a browser to go back out to his own website to install a trapdoor. So from that point on, everything is host. You can, you know, if the gateway is the only defense here, you know, the gateway at your workplace is the only defense from a, you know, to prevent a hacker from opening a connection from Office 1 back to the hacker's own site. That's the only defense.
Is he referring to a web proxy now?
Hmm?
Is he referring to a web proxy?
A web proxy?
Or as far as not allowing that browser on Office 1 to access certain sites outside of the office.
Yeah, but there are so many other ways to get your box, you know, to install a trap door on your box. So, you know, so this is the dangerous one. The first one, you know, can, you know, people can use it to goof off and, you know, use their home machine for goofing off, and you know, the administrator cannot see it. But this way, the other way, you know, actually can compromise the security of the office, of Office One. But on the other hand, it allows you to work from home. So
it's,
sorry?
You have to use the password email to get back to work email.
Correct?
Correct. You have to have two logins, like that, password.
Yeah, if someone hacks into your desktop and, you know, everything is hosed, I mean, that's just gone. That's just gone now. Okay, so does everybody see, you know, how the two, you know, they're very similar, except they're, you know, they work in exactly the opposite ways. One allows you to go from your office and remote back onto your home box, and the other one allows you to go from the home box back to the work machine so you can remotely control the machine in your office.
How difficult would it be for somebody to hit that SSH connection by finding the port if you didn't use...
They just have the port scanned.
And if you didn't use this...
Nmap. Yep, that's a unit.
So it wouldn't matter if you use port 22 or what port.
Doesn't matter what port number you use. You know, they can probe the ports and they can find out what it is for. Not only that port is open, but they can also, you know, tell, oh, this port is actually SSH. So you can renumber to anything, they will still find it. Yep.
There's software out there that doesn't show what ports you
They, you still you will still have to expose it to your own machine. Now, do you make this?
Yeah.
So if someone can okay, the only way to make this more secure is to set up NetBox here. So that your NetBox says, you know, I will only accept connections from a certain IP address, which is the IP address of that gateway. You can do it. I mean, SSH is very, very flexible in terms of, you know, it can limit by IP address. It can also limit in terms of, you know, what you can use to log in. In other words, you can turn off password login and turn on, you know, key pair, you know, login. So when you turn on key pair login, then, you know, there's no way to brute force, you know, and try, you know, and actually try to guess your password, because there's no password. Someone actually needs to have your private key in order to make that connection. So there are ways to make, you know, NetBox more secure so that it cannot be easily hacked into, you know, through port 22. But when you make NetBox, you know, that secure, then you can no longer remote back into NetBox, you know, through your cell phone, because your cell phone, you know, is going to have a different IP address every single time. So, you know, there are pluses and minuses, you know. A static IP? Can you? I don't think you can do that, because, you know, the your ISP, you know, your ISP is set up to use DHCP. So if your phone is running a DHCP client, you know, the lease will be up, and then it will, the DHCP server can assign a different IP address to you. Yes, you can. But NetBox is checking the IP address of the client. So it will still be a different IP address. You know, the client will still have a different IP address. So are there any questions about this? That's basically your homework assignment. Except. I don't want you guys to actually do this to your home machine. So this whole thing is going to be done by
virtual machines.
The whole thing is going to be done by virtual machines. Basically, this part is your 10.0 network, you know, through VDE. This is your host environment. So your host environment will pretend to be the office machine, and then, you know, everything on the other side will pretend to be your home network. Okay. But then someone's going to say, but that's not going to work, because, you know, Office One actually has connection to the home network. I mean, so any connection will work. That's why in the homework assignment, I specify, you know, a dash L option already when you start up slurp VDE. And what that does is it emulates this effect here. You can only make connections to the 10.0.2 network through a port forwarding mechanism. So that makes it more realistic and resembles this picture a little more. Any questions? Well, the NetBox can be any box. Can be a router. In other words, you know, if you have a really programmable gateway, you can combine these two boxes together. Your NetBox and your gateway can be combined to one. Any questions? So does anyone want to do this?
Yeah, I see all kinds of potential with this. I see a lot of potential with this.
Oh, forwarding, you know, PNC is one thing. Yeah. If you forward PPP, that's an entirely different thing. What is PPP?
That's your brother.
Does anyone have a dial-up connection? When you use a dial-up connection, it's called a PPP connection. It stands for point-to-point protocol. Yep. And a PPP is also another way to do tunneling. But you can combine PPP with SSH to do basically a poor man's VPN. Virtual private network. Huh?
ISDN the same?
ISDN?
Yeah.
But this is done. This is done through a switched network, not a dedicated line. Yep. But PPP can be very dangerous too, because it's also a tunneling protocol, so you can potentially be opening up, you know, one side or the other side to a lot of attacks. Any questions about this? That's your new homework assignment. But I think this one is kind of interesting. It's interesting in many, many ways because, you know, from up to this point, we look at SSH and go like, yeah, you can use it to transfer files. You can open up a terminal on the other side. Well, it actually can do a whole lot more than that. Alrighty. So let me save the file and stop the recording so I can. Oh, I just overwrote the file. Ugh. It's okay, the video is there, so. No, not the recording, just the file itself, you know, so I can just take a screen, I can roll back and then take a screenshot and, you know, that's the other configuration. So, no biggie.
So the video is intact?
The video is intact. Or did I start the video? Yep, the video is still going.